welcome to the SciShow Talk Show. It's that day on SciShow where we talk to interesting people about interesting stuff. And today we have the new host of Crash Course Physics, Dr. Shinny Samara.
Hi.
I'm so excited to have you here.
It's so nice to be on these couches.
Do you like this couch?
It's very comfortable.
We got it just for you.
No, you didn't.
It's a lie. We don't even own that couch. We don't even own any of this. This is just some place downtown that they let us borrow.
That makes me feel really special.
Yeah, we borrowed it just for you.
Thank you.
I'm super excited about Crash Course Physics. You're here recording it right now. Did you just finish a long day of physics?
No, I've just got off a plane.
Oh, okay.
And like literally less than an hour ago. Yeah. And just really excited to talk to you about this.
How did you get interested in physics, science, engineering stuff?
So my father is a mechanical engineer, and he came over to London from Sri Lanka to study at South Bank University. Back then it was called South Bank Poly.
I don't know what either of those things
are. Oh, really?
Let's be honest.
All right, go into it, because my dad will be like, why are you telling them that? So South Bank University is a great university for engineering, and that's what he studied. He met my mum at university, and they got married, and then 3 years later had me. And being the eldest, there was a lot of kind of expectation for me to take over the family business. Mm.
Is there an actual family business?
Yeah. My dad ran a mechanical and electrical consultancy practice for building services. So all the engineering that happens in a building is down to engineers like my dad. And so, yeah, I studied mechanical engineering at Brunel University in West London. And then really found fluid dynamics interesting. So fluids are defined as anything that is gaseous or a liquid.
Right, anything that flows around, yeah.
Yeah, and I just loved the idea of visualizing the invisible, because normally most fluids are invisible, like water,
certainly
air.
The air. Yeah, even like the existence of air was something we didn't really know about for quite a while.
And yeah.
Of course, we get hit by wind, but not really think of it as a thing that exists and wouldn't like slapping into molecules all the time.
And that's what's so fascinating about fluid dynamics is the power of things like wind or the power of air. I mean, even just coming over from LA today, it was like such bumpy flight conditions. And you just feel like you're this little flea, especially in those Bombardier planes.
Yeah, it's the little ones. Sorry about that.
Yeah, it's the mountain ranges. I am the most paranoid flyer. Because
well, you do it a lot, though, so you must not be the most.
I don't know. I feel sorry for the person that sits next to me on the plane, because I'm kind of like grabbing onto things. And before I studied engineering, I was fine in a plane. I was like, whatever. And then now I know so much about convection currents and turbulence models.
Well, you know all the fluid dynamics. You need to know the structural engineering stuff so you know how strong those plane wings are.
Yeah, that's finite element analysis. That's a thing.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah. No, I went more into the things that float rather than...
Well, fluid dynamics has always seemed to me some of the most complicated physics out there because, of course, it's always made up of these sort of basically infinite numbers of discrete particles bumping into each other and bumping into things, and what do they do when they're moving in a certain endless, like...
And almost infinite possibilities of external conditions.
Right.
So, like, if the temperature changes, that's going to change the way things flow. Yeah,
pressure changes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Good old gas law.
Oh, yeah, it's all down to Boyle. Boyle's good old law. Thanks for that.
So, what did you think when we reached out to you about Crash Course Physics?
I was really, really excited about working in an online space. Honestly, because I've done TV for quite a number of years now. And it's such a different experience being online. Just, the best thing about it is the interaction with the audience. It's instantaneous. Like, if people don't like something, or if they do, they tell you. And I love that, because with TV, you're kind of looking down a camera lens. You don't really engage.
Right, and you make the full season, and then you start airing them, and it's like, well, if they don't like something, we can't change it now.
Yeah.
We've shot all of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's phenomenal to just experience that. I can't describe it. But, like, everyone just feels like a friend.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
So far.
Well,
until we do something in physics where they're like, no, don't like it.
Well, there will always be haters on the internet. I'm sure. Did we ever have that conversation?
I think we did.
I try to give people a little bit of a warning.
Yeah.
But just so you're ready. But mostly people are very nice.
Yeah. I think what we're doing is great.
Yeah, me too.
Be nice to us. I'm looking forward to providing people with free online education.
Yeah.
Like, that's another thing that's really great about this opportunity. Because I think personally, you know, my parents come from what is maybe considered third world countries. Mm-hmm. And through education, they carved out a pretty decent life in London. Mm-hmm. And so if I can help to educate and allow people to reach their full potential in STEM, then I feel that would make me feel good.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah, it's really wonderful to be able to work in this space where, like, we get to be creative and make stuff that we like, and also that seems like it's good for the world.
I think it's good that you're tackling such diverse subjects as well.
Yeah.
So
it's really fun. It's really interesting that we have have all these concurrent courses, and they all get, you know, lots of people are watching all of them, and, you know, that's something that I really want to foster in the world, is people who have a you know, not just deep knowledge but broad knowledge. And so it seems a little bit like we've been pushing not in that direction for a while, because deep knowledge is so important for actually getting things done, but broad knowledge is kind of what you need to be a human. And hopefully Crash Course is helping to make that happen. Now, this is obviously a SciShow talk show where we talked mostly about Crash Course, but hopefully people don't mind. And hopefully you know what Crash Course is. And if you don't, you can go to youtube.com/crashcourse. Do you want to meet an animal?
I do.
Okay, let's do that. All right, what do we got?
This is Sydney, the brush-tailed bettong, and she's cuddled up right now because she's nocturnal, and these guys are pretty prey-driven.
Right.
Right? Or
right, opposite of that.
Yes.
Predator-driven.
Predator-driven. So they're prey animals, and they're going to be very instinctually afraid of things. But look.
Oh, except for the licking.
She's licking.
Not afraid of your hand.
She's a giant squirrel.
She kind of looks like
a giant squirrel.
Kind of. She's got the ears and the eyes.
Well, it's the fur. It's all the fur color.
Yeah, that's true, too. Yeah. But she has tiny little, let's see if we can get her a little bit more positioned here so you can see.
Oh,
this
yeah.
would be her normal stance. She has these huge back legs, and let's see if I can pull this out for you.
Oh.
Oh, wow.
Big ol' rat tail.
Kinda, except rat tails are naked. So she is most closely related to a kangaroo.
Okay.
Wow.
So the brush-tailed bettong, also known as a woily, would you like to try and hold her in your lap?
Woily?
Let me try.
Okay, so scooch over here and get your legs straight. We'll get her little blanket.
Like that?
She might. She might not care.
Did you say woily?
Woily is what they call them in Africa, or Australia. Here you go. All right. And she might just want to come right back to me.
Oh, yeah.
She likes you.
The front legs look kind of squirrely. The back legs look like kangaroo.
Not at all,
yeah.
Yes.
So is she a baby?
She is not a baby. She's about 2 years old, and they mature at about 6 months. So she is fully grown. What do you think, Sydney? You're doing so good.
Sydney. From Sydney?
So not from Sydney. More the grasslands of Australia, not the deserts.
Right, okay. Oh,
look
at your big legs. Look at your weird three toes.
Yeah, kangaroo.
Kangaroos have three toes?
Yes, yeah. And she does have a pouch.
Oh, wow.
It's down there. So you can't really see it. Actually, the pouches that we've learned of in cartoons, it's kind of a misnomer, because they're not like this slit where you can just like open them up and put like a fanny pack type thing.
Right, you know, you keep your cell phone in there.
Yeah, yeah, not so much. Not so much.
Okay.
It's more of like, and let's see if she'll let me actually feel inside there.
She just stopped. She was like, huh?
She was like, what are you doing?
Her head was like, did you just really? Did
my
you
fingers
really
in there, you
that?
See that?
So it's like an orifice.
It kinda, yeah.
It's just like another hole.
Hole that's lined with skin.
Okay.
And fur.
Yeah.
Okay.
But so
no
it's not,
fur.
Okay.
Just skin.
And the purpose is
to hold the baby. And so the interesting thing is that these guys will give birth to a joey, and it's teeny tiny. It climbs up into their pouch.
Okay.
And then it will, and it doesn't have really developed back legs. It'll attach to a nipple in there, and then its jaws will fuse shut. so that it can't fall. So she's gonna be hopping around like crazy, mm-hmm. and it's gonna be bouncing around in there.
So it's just attached to that nipple.
It's attached to that nipple.
Never lets go.
Yeah, until it grows, develops enough that it can like move itself around and reposition itself if it needs to. And then its jaws will develop more and it'll be good.
So it's just a fold of skin. It's not in any way inside of the body. It has no mucous membranes. It's all skin in there.
Except for the nipples. Yep. Okay. So it'd be like if we had like an extra flap of skin that came over
your nipples.
Our nipples. And then
it's as if that,
I mean, and then at the top of it, it's like almost like a drawstring or at the
right, okay.
edge of it. Like, so they have a muscle that can constrict like this.
A little
and
pouch.
And how long
sphincter.
Does it stay in there?
It takes 4 months for them to develop in there. So they're pregnant for about like 2 weeks and okay. they give birth and then 4 months for it to develop and then leave the pouch and be able to pop around on its own. And they're super cute. They're
That's
about this
amazing.
Big.
And that's why they're closely related to kangaroos, for
right,
that reason.
Marsupials.
They're marsupials, yeah. And they're closely related to kangaroos because on the tree that they split off at the same time as kangaroos. So kangaroos, wallabies, wallaroos, bitongs, they're all very similarly related.
Host of animals that I've just never seen.
They're so cool.
Because they're on the complete other side of the planet to where I'm from.
And we
weirdly have that one marsupial in the new world here.
Yeah.
The possum.
The opossum.
Well, what's really?
There's a possum. It's a prosimian.
Wait a second. Are you telling me that there is a possum and an opossum and that they're two different things?
I am.
Why do we do this to ourselves? So, the opossum, the one that you see dead on the side of the road in Florida a lot.
That's an opossum.
It's an opossum.
Yes.
And it is a marsupial.
Yes.
And are there more than one species of opossum in America?
No.
Just the one?
Just the one.
Okay.
Just the one.
And
how long did it take
her?
You to have this relationship?
Well, she was actually born at Animal Wonder, so these guys are critically endangered in the wild. And so we were part of a conservation breeding program. We had a breeding pair, and they actually had 5 joeys at Animal Wonders before we sent them on to a larger facility that had more connections than we did and could get them into bigger facilities for propagate the species better.
Because they were so good at breeding.
They were really good at breeding, and we didn't have enough places to put the babies. So we sent them and all the babies to facilities that could better propagate mm-hmm. their species, but we kept one for education. And so we've had Sydney since she came out of the pouch. And so...
Oh, so she really knows
she
you.
She really knows us. And, you know...
I'm envious of your relationship. I want to hug her.
You can keep petting her. She's doing really good.
But you were saying she might bite?
She's bit me a couple times already. Okay. You guys, I know you haven't noticed, but she doesn't bite very
hard.
Oh,
bit you a couple times during this talk?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You hit that well.
She was just a couple of them were like little love nibbles, because she's licking me, and she's
love
like,
bites.
Oh, I wonder if this tastes good, and
is
it didn't.
Is this food?
And then
food?
Was, and I tried to block her from jumping off the onto the floor,
and she's like,
I want to go down there. And she's like, okay. She resigned herself.
Let us know if you need a Band-Aid.
Oh, she doesn't bite that hard. She doesn't bite that hard, huh? What do you think?
Oh, what a weirdo.
So these guys...
Sorry.
Nice.
Sorry.
There's so many animals mixed
yeah,
into one.
Uh-huh.
So I want to see if she'll let me. I want to show off this really cool tail. See how it rolls like that?
Oh,
and
naturally
you can see those bends?
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is a prehensile tail. Now, it's a semi-prehensile tail. She can't actually, like, hang from it, so she wouldn't be up in the trees anyway. But she uses that tail to help her gather sticks and leaves together because she has little T-Rex arms. She can't really hold much with her front arms there. And so she'll gather branches up, and then she'll bounce them back to her nest to make a big cozy nest.
What does she eat?
She eats something really interesting. She's an omnivore. She's going to eat a lot of different things, mostly plant material, vegetables and stuff. But her biggest part of her diet in the wild is a mushroom that grows under the ground, so a fungus. And she digs up, she has a really keen sense of smell, and so she'll find those mushrooms, dig them up, eat them. Now, the coolest thing that they do is that they digest them in a certain way in their gut. They have special microbes in there that help break it down, and so when she poops, there's extra access to the sugars in that feces, so the plants can actually absorb more sugar out of that fertilizer than they can other feces, and it helps the plant grow 3 times faster and stronger.
So you got really good fertilizer coming into your place.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So these guys are really cool, which is why it's so sad that they're critically endangered. It's because they help their ecosystem so much, this tiny little marsupial.
That's fascinating. Thank you, Sydney, for joining us. Thank you, Jesse. You can see more of Jesse's work at Animal Wonders, youtube.com/AnimalWondersMontana. You can see Shinny, Dr. Shinny Samara, on our new Crash Course Physics series. And you can see me on SciShow at youtube.com/SciShow, as always. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here and being interesting. And if you want to keep getting smarter with us, you can go to youtube.com/SciShow and subscribe. I'm going to go ahead and say that this is the second oldest thing just because it's a fish.
It is fish.
And fish are older than this looks like a land animal, and this looks like a land animal.